I'm Emeli. I am a singer, and I also play trombone in the commercial department. And then we have Joey.
Hi, guys. I am a saxophonist in the commercial department, and I am also a writer and arranger for some of the bands.
This is our American Music Podcast. This is a podcast that we have through AMP, which is our student organization that helps organize different events for our commercial program. Today we have Professor Scott Lee, and he is a composer, arranger, producer, and educator, and he teaches applied jazz bass here at Kutztown University. He actually released an album recently called Streaming, and you can find that anywhere that you listen to music.
Good morning to all of you.
Hi, Scott.
Hi, Joey.
Hey, how are you doing today?
Everything is fine. Another lovely day in paradise here in Manhattan.
Cool. Did you get a lot of snow last night? We got a lot of snow.
We got very little.
Oh, really?
Really?
Barely noticeable.
Wow. Well, lucky for you guys.
Yeah.
If you could like talk about your college experience and how bass like just so happened to be the thing that you wanted to do.
Yeah. I was at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, and I was playing on the tennis team. I played junior tennis, the tournament circuit in the summers for years. And so I kind of thought I was going to do something maybe related to tennis or something. And I was good enough to play on a great team, but I wasn't one of the best players on the team. So, my future in playing any kind of professional tennis was probably not going to happen, in all honesty. So a friend of mine, my mother is a piano teacher and a church organist. My father was a lover of jazz, so I heard jazz around the house growing up. So, you know, I had a kind of an interest in music. I love soul, Southern, you know, soul music, Motown, all that stuff. That was my real passion, and still is. I still am a big fan of it. So anyway, at Chapel Hill, I said, well, you know, I want to play sports. I never want to take piano lessons from my mother. Nobody should take lessons, you know, inside the family. Yeah. But anyway, so I said, maybe I'll take piano lessons. I took piano lessons for 6 months, and my piano player, my piano teacher said, let's go to Raleigh. There's a jazz club called the Frog and Nightgown, and Bill Evans Trio was playing there. And so Marty Morrell, Eddie Gomez, and Bill Evans were playing, and I heard that, and I heard Eddie Gomez play, and I decided that's what I wanted to do. And I came back to campus and I essentially hung up my tennis racket. I left the tennis team and I just went to the music department and looked for a bass. And I found a metal bass that was spray painted brown, an aluminum bass. And that was my instrument. And so I just started teaching myself and then I got an electric bass and started playing a few gigs. And then, quite honestly, that was kind of my junior year in college, and I got my degree in American Studies, liberal arts, right? But I was on the side, you know, kind of playing around with this bass idea. So started doing a few little gigs in my senior year, and then two other friends who were actually really accomplished musicians. One of them, Alanette.
Oh, yeah.
From Spirit Music. So Alan and I and this other section player from my hometown, Scott Adair, we all moved to Boston. And he went to Berkeley, Scott did. Alan went to New England Conservatory, and I went to the bandstand. And because I'd had enough of school. So anyway, when I got to Boston is when I really started learning. That's where I met Joe Lovano and Billy Drews and John Scofield and all these people. And they took me under their wing as a beginner. And I really knew nothing. And but they took me under their wing. And so I got hooked up with some great musicians, and I just kind of tried to play catch up with them from that point on. And it was, it created problems because, you know, once again, the you want to justify their faith in you. So I was just be working so hard. I messed my arm up from trying to practice too much, too hard in all the wrong ways. And so I ended up being playing in show bands and playing, you know, weddings and the whole thing, just like everybody else was doing. And so that my training was all on bandstand, and consequently part of me regrets not having been to music school, because it would have made a lot of things a lot easier. Mm-hmm. But the fact is, being in Boston with so many students, so many music schools, and so many young musicians between Berkeley and, they're just, it's full of schools for music, and musicians are everywhere. So I got the advantage of being able to just play with them all the time. And so that's kind of how I got started with that.
Cool. You talked about, you were talking about how you practiced, and during that time, even though you didn't go to music school, what were some things that you did with practicing and stuff like that?
Well, I got a few books. There's one out by Richard Davis, and maybe mm-hmm. At that point, I don't even think Ron Carter had anything else, but it was just, trying to listen to music, read books, look at books. And quite honestly, it was fairly haphazard. I mean, there was, there really wasn't there was no organized pursuit. So to speak. It was just like, I'll go and try and make a session and find out yet again what little I know, and all these guys are so good, and here I'm trying to hold on for dear life, right? Mm-hmm. And so I didn't really learn how to practice until many years later.
Yeah.
And I had the benefit of most people your age, and unless you were involved in the music world of Boston, would not know, but Charlie Benacus is a very famous teacher. He taught mm-hmm. every instrument, and almost everybody that went through Boston studied with Charlie Benacus, and I did as well. And he was my first actual formal kind of training. And I would practice, 50 hours a week for a 30-minute lesson. Like playing giant steps in all keys and mm-hmm. playing major, minor. I mean, to this day, it's still the most that I learned in the shortest amount of time of any period in my life. And he was a piano player, it's not like he was teaching me bass. So I did study with, in Boston, Tiny Martin, who was with the BSO, so classical stuff, because I figured if you're going to play the bass, there is a bow that goes along with that.
Yeah.
So it was all just kind of what I formulated for myself. And I did a good job or a poor job is hard to say at this point, but, being able to be surrounded by the challenge of playing with really good, really good musicians mm-hmm. is kind of like all the incentive you need. You hear their sound, their commitment to it, their energy, and you can't help but be inspired to, go back and try and get better every day. And so that's kind of what I did, but it had no structure to it other than just trying to get it where I could without paying tuition and going back to school.
Yeah.
That was the issue.
As you were talking about that, you got into a little bit of your professional career, and we know that you've played with a lot of different people, and we just wanted to know what are some highlights that you've had during your career? And we wanted to ask you, what was it like playing with people like Chet Baker and Nancy Wilson and those kind of people?
I came through at a time where a lot of those people, Zoot Sims and Chet and Freddie Hubbard and all those people I got to play some with. And not to mention, my contemporaries like Kenny Werner and Joe Lovano and all those kind of people, right? Those were people roughly my own age. But the older ones had a hard edge to them. Even though they might be nice people, they came up in a kind of a tougher world in playing music. Female singers playing with big bands were fairly, they had a certain kind of armor up, you know, and rightfully so. I mean, because, you know, the bands were just completely, you know, chauvinistic kind of male world. Don't give the singer kind of any due respect and all that kind of stuff. And so they that's kind of what they had. And I now work with a lot of singers that were Morgana King, Chris Connor, and just, you know, a whole ton of them. That you had to, you kind of had to be, you kind of had to hold your own. And at the same time, you had to suffer a lot of times, kind of withering insults and criticism and stuff like that. And Chet is kind of maybe the perfect example of somebody that was like, he really embodied the saint and the demon all in one person. I mean, he was like, the stories about, you know, playing with Chet, right? I mean, I just have so many of them. It's not the time or place to go into a bunch of them, but the long and short of it is that he was generally a very gentle, good man. And yet he had his own, you know, kind of demons that had to do with, you know, drug abuse and just kind of being from a hard scrabble background, you know, and having a difficult home life and father and all that kind of stuff. But he would be, you know, I mean, one day, just a quick one, you know, I mean, on the train going to somewhere, Denmark, I think, and traveling 10 hours on the train. And we were playing cards, the rhythm section and shit, and he was getting beat and he was drinking. He rarely does drink. And so he was getting really angry. And I would personally was beating him. And he says, I'm going to, you know, I'm going to wear your hands down to the first nub or something tonight. You know, you're not going to want to be on that bandstand with me, pal. And so sure enough, you know, we got there late, but he played and in trying to wear, and we were young, he wasn't, and in trying to carry through with the threat, he tried, I mean, he played, it's meant 30 courses on up-tempo tunes till he literally couldn't play another note. And so, you know, we were about to die ourselves. And yet, you know, he was so ornery when he was like this, when that demon side of his came out, you know, it's almost like, you know, he would rather die than let you kind of show that you were not going to give in. And so, you know, he would call to him, and that night, that particular night of all things was a live recording going all over, you know, Scandinavia, Denmark, everywhere. And he asked, and he just says, okay, SPM player, you know, Milestones, but the bebop tune Milestones, not the other one that came along later. And piano player said, no. He asked the drummer, no. And then he asked me, and I said, no. And he said, one, two, three, four. So this is being broadcast all over Europe. And here he starts a tune, and it's a complicated tune. And here none of us know the tune. And so we were, you know, thrown out there, you know, to twist in the wind. And you know, so, you know, it's like, what do you do? Everybody was, you know, we were sweating, trying to like, okay. And, you know, it's one thing to, I mean, if you know the melody of a tune, you can almost hear what changes go underneath it. I think y'all would probably recognize that. You can suss that out, right? But if you have no idea what the melody is, you don't know the key, you don't know anything. And yet, and so now you have the added pressure of it being a recording and a live broadcast. And you're all just sounding, you know, everybody's like, oh my God, deliver me. And so he would do that kind of stuff. And which is like, you know, and then the next day it was just like, forgotten. We'd go around, you know, we'd go to Berlin and he would like, hey, let's go. I'm going to rent a car. Scott, go. Let's go. Let's go see the sights in Berlin kind of thing. So, you know what I mean? It's like, you don't know. It's like, you never know which kind of guy was going to show up. You would never know when, you know, say a singer, you know, you'd be her darling bass player. And then the next set, it's like, you know, she's embarrassing you on the bandstand. What do you mean you can't transpose this? What do you mean you don't know this tune? You know what I'm saying? So those kind of things, that doesn't happen much anymore. But when I came along, there was this attitude about, you know, I'm going to put the younger ones through their paces because I was put through it. And so therefore, you know, why should you not have to suffer some of the stuff that I suffered? So I'm going to see if you have any backbone or not, that kind of thing. So anyway, that's, you know, playing with my own contemporaries, you know, was like that was not at work at all. But playing with you know, the older musicians, there was still some of that around. And if they can make your life on the bandstand miserable, they might just do it. Just for the fun of it, for them.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. Just another question. Do you think that that musicians now should still be doing that to younger musicians, like trying to see if they have a backbone and like pushing them that way, or do you think that the way that it's happening now is okay? Like, what do you? How do you feel about that?
Emily, I would say that I prefer now.
Yeah.
I just, that kind of prove yourself vibe is more about trying to elevate oneself at the expense of somebody else. And I, you know, it's, I'm not sure what, quite honestly, except for telling the stories about it, there's not a whole lot that's fun or positive about it. And, you know, and hey, good stories are good stories. And, you know, a lot of times the best stories are about, you know, the most embarrassing kind of moments that you've had to experience or whatever. But in terms of, I do not think it's necessary to become a better, in becoming a better musician to go through that stuff.
Yeah.
And I think most people now are motivated enough to want to be a good musician, to work hard at what you do, and because you love it and you love musicians. I mean, that should be enough incentive right there to do what you need to do. I don't think it's that thing has certainly gone out of style because the people that did it are dead or nearing that or retired or something like that. And but you know, that the stories are extraordinary about, I mean, and some of them are just, you know, they are, you know, just like make you quake. Oh gosh, how awful. And, but you know, it was something to go through. I mean, you know, you could go through that stuff playing a club date too.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, guys just not telling you what the tune is, not telling you what the key is, and segueing, going through eight tunes as in segues before it, you know, it ends. Jumping to the bridge of another tune, just to mess with you. And those are old school guys. Those, you know, that nobody, because now it's, you know, it's a whole different world now. But but no, it's not a necessary part of, you know, learning the ropes, as it were.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah, I think a lot of times now, with younger musicians like us, I do think there's a lot of nicer folk all around. We're generally taught one of the best qualities of some of the best musicians now is just being kind to people.
Yes.
And I think that when musicians now get on the bandstand, they're more just in it for the music and the sound. And when they're all there and playing, it's way more of a collaborative effort.
What we were talking about, which used to be a lot of jazz clubs would have cut sessions where, you know, four tenor players would try and best each other. And that kind of thing, that kind of competitive element has definitely gone by the wayside and let it stay buried, you know, as far as I'm concerned. Because to me, it's like bands that, you know, that are feeling the joy of playing their music in front of people and doing it with to the best of their ability, they're going to play better. It's going to sound better. And if it's coming from, you know, a place of anxiety and fear that, you know, that somebody's going to try and mess with you. I don't think, you know, that to me is kind of like an unnecessary aspect. It just doesn't need to be there. I agree with you, Joey. It's like that's, you know, it's hard enough to do it well. without all this, you know, anguish as baggage.
Scott, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about, since we mentioned your most recent album, I wanted to take some time to talk to you more about your process for songwriting or arranging. And is that more of a collaborative effort because I know you recorded with your trio. Do you like to write more by yourself a lot of the times? I just wanted to hear a little bit about that and what your process is like.
Yes. Well, this CD is the third from this group. It's a Spanish piano player, Yago Vasquez, and a New York drummer, Jeff Hirschfield, who's been on the scene. He's been an old friend for many, many years, you know, maybe 40. So anyway, but we play a lot together. The trio has been kind of a workshop where we studied improvisational concepts. Before the pandemic, we were into a thing where we were practicing and we play together and do rehearsals. And we were just working on playing super fast tempos. And this is just an example of the workshop aspect of what we do. So we're always trying to like challenge ourselves to do something. So this is what we were doing. And we would, you know, set the metronome at 375, 400. And just to see, you know, as a challenge for ourselves personally and for the group. So, but that is just to say, as a kind of a preliminary comment about, it's kind of the nature of what this trio is. And it's really exemplified, I think, in this last CD, which is the third in a series. The first is called, it's kind of called the Stream Trio, and the first one, then second stream. And this was just called Streaming, and they put it under my name, but it's still this one was on Steeplechase Records, so they decided to put it under my name for whatever reason. So the interesting thing about this one, I think, is that in the liner notes, their explanation of what we're doing is kind of laid out fairly clearly, I think. And this, we do this thing that Jeff Hirschfeld and a different piano player, Russ Lawson, years ago came up with called The Game. And a lot of this CD employs the use of the game, which is this idea that you make form the improvisation as well as the soloing and the normal improvisation that we would think of that's in most of jazz. So what happens here is that we decide, as we're putting the tune together, we decide upon how we want to reshape this tune. And so we come up with these agreed upon cues, and they're aural cues, so there nobody has to look around in the trio to say, okay, are we ready to go somewhere else? Nobody has to send up a flare. It's all about listening. So we've learned to listen on a different level, so that when we are playing along in a solo, a person will give a cue. Now that could be anything. It could be changing keys, it could be a metric modulation, it could be an addition of a cadence or another interlude of some sort, but what it does is it keeps the form malleable. So the form itself becomes an improvisation. You never know who's going to cue what. Anybody can cue. It can be the drummer, the piano player, or the bass player. So this keeps the music really fresh and exciting. It keeps it full of surprises because we don't know. Therefore, a listener couldn't possibly know. But we could be playing Willow Wheat for Me, or I Remember April, doesn't matter. We usually do this on original tunes, but we can do it also on standards. We agree upon the cues, and so that every tune has its own unpredictable shape and organization. And so this keeps the music from becoming kind of stale, which I think has kind of become a problem in the formatting in the jazz world of playing jazz standards, is that you play the head. Somebody takes a solo, another solo, maybe trade with the drums and play the bass player, and then you take it out. And so you just have this cycling, repetitive form that, you know, in a certain sense, it has a certain, it's the repetitiveness of it makes it kind of tired to me. this allows, to me, this is where I see jazz going in a certain sense, and that this keeps everybody on their toes as a musician, because we don't know. So we are surprised. We get, you know, it's very hard to listen like you normally do, but then we have to listen on a second level for all these kind of complicated turns of direction. And, you know, do you remember the cue? And there's a, the game part of it is that you can give false cues. You can give, there's all kinds of ways you can do it to make it, to actually employ literally a musical game aspect of this. So a lot of it is absolutely hilarious. We fall apart, especially in learning how to do this, we fell apart more than we actually accomplished what we were after, because we were having to listen so intently. And one cue, one tune could have 15 different cues that you have to memorize, not only what the cue is, but where it throws you, where it directs you to go next. So this CD, it employs quite a bit of the game.
So those days that you just wrote a song every day, what was your approach to like writing a song? Like
first thing I played on the bass, well, the first thing I might be hearing when I'm, you know, stacking wood, I don't know, whatever, if a melody pops through, you know, the first thing you got to do is always have a notebook ready for all these little gems of melodies or rhythmic ideas or chord progression you like, whatever it may be. Always have something, a place to where you can document it. And maybe you just sing the melody into your phone, whatever, you know. But you need to make sure that you don't, when those little things, they're like little gifts, little jewels that get presented to you. And you don't want to let them get away, because I can't tell you the number of times where I thought, oh, that's so hip, I'll never forget it. And literally, it was forgotten, never to be regained. And, you know, and then you really feel stupid. But my point is, Emily, when I would, what I generally would do is I would, almost like the first melody when I start to practice, I just kind of let my, and I'm not practicing anything that has any kind of regimen to it. I'm just kind of letting my thoughts just kind of float around the instrument, playing whatever. And invariably, something within the first 60 seconds, a melody played, I like that. And that would be, now I'd write that out and keep playing with it for a minute. And, you know, sometimes the, we have a little thing that some of us do, which is a 20-minute rule. Like, if you can't get it out in 20 minutes, maybe it's not that strong or whatever. Or at least, in other words, you can tune, you know, everybody's got a different way to go about this. But I'm a believer in just getting the kind of the purity of it out and not obsess over every little note. Just try and get as much of it down so that you're really capturing kind of the essence of what that original idea was. So that's what I did. First thing that I played that I thought, I kind of like that. And then I would start to develop that.
Yeah.
And invariably I tend to go with, like I say, everybody writes different. Piano players are certainly going to write differently than say a bass player. It's just, you know, it makes sense that should be the case. But I would say that, you know, the, whatever you come up with, generally speaking, the melody is kind of the main deal for me.
Yeah.
Look at every song in a fake book, they're there for the most part, 98% of them are in that book because the melody is memorable and it's singable and memorable. And if you start there, then for me as a bass player, once I have that, then I start, the root motion becomes the issue. Mm-hmm. In root motion, you know, as a bass player, just playing a walking bass line is you're just playing a quarter note melody all the time. Yeah. And so to me, it's like a strong bass player really understands that, you know, melodic movement of those quarter notes, you know, the contours of it, the leaps, the shape of it, all that kind of stuff. So root motion is a favorite thing. And I can always tell a bass player's tune by the root motion. Whoever, you know, a bass player, I know that a bass player had to write this tune kind of thing. So the root motion. And then after that, I just fill in the inner harmony as, you know, as, you know, what, you know, what the melody dictates, you know, because they're going to be chord tones or scale tones. Mm-hmm. And then, so that's going to almost by itself define what the harmonic context of that, you know, bar, that chord symbol is going to be. So that, so I start with melody, then go to the root motion, the bass part, and then I come back and fill in what I think is the inner harmony.
Yeah. Oh, cool. All right. Yeah. One of my favorite things that like bass players do when they improvise is just walk. And like a really great walk, like as an improvisation, that's just like, I don't know, that's really cool to me because it's so simple, but yet so, I don't know, it's composed very well and they're composing on the spot. So, you know,
absolutely. Really cool. And I agree with you. And I got to tell you, I'm glad you brought that up because I never in my playing days before COVID, I never did that enough. And for me, because I really started kind of late in life, I always felt like, you know, I had to get certain technical things and to, you know, certain skills at soloing that had to do with, you know, playing higher on the bass and all those kind of things. And so that would be the focus of a solo because that was kind of what I was working on. Mm-hmm. And yet when I quite honestly, I think the reason I avoided it was because I thought it was too simple. Mm-hmm. Like in other words, a simple ego fabrication.
Yeah.
You know, a lack of confidence mm-hmm. on my part was why I kind of avoided doing that. And yet, when I hear somebody else do it, I think, why don't I do that? I got into a habit of. Mm-hmm. Not doing it because I thought, well, does anybody really care? I've already done that. I've been doing that for 15 minutes in this tune. I'm tired of it. I want to break it up, and now I want to play, you know, like a horn player. Mm-hmm. And so, and yet, you know, what it does do, as a matter of fact, is it draws attention to how you can make beautiful melodies with just playing a walking bass line. And so what I have been doing before for the last 10 or 15 minutes in this long tune, all of a sudden with nobody else a wall of sound that all these other instruments are making, all of a sudden I'm featuring and it's just bass doing that. Mm-hmm. So you're clearing everything else out so that people can hear what I was just doing, but now they can really hear it. There's no interference with any other sound or any kind of, you know, instruments interfering kind of, you know, it's a feature thing.
Yeah.
So it, I mean, there are great reasons for doing it. And quite honestly, I'm, you know, kind of hesitant to admit my, what I have not done. And yet it's a good reminder that it's really a good way to feature a different side of bass playing.
Yeah.
Good. All right. Good question. Good point.
Kind of going along with that. I know, like, even not even just on the bandstand, but when you step into a practice room and you're feeling that same way, like, I've got to get better just so I can be above this next person when I go out and play. I think that's the complete wrong mindset to have. And what I think a lot of people do in the practice room now in terms of getting ready for playing with more people and collaborating to have a better enjoyment of music is they try to get more in tune with their own instrument and they have their own certain routines. Some do yoga, some do breathing exercises, different types of warming up. And Scott, I know that you have your own routine and regimen for when you're practicing, not even just playing the bass. I wanted to know if you could elaborate on what you do a little bit, the name of the certain practice that you do. Any of that would be great.
Sure. And I applaud the, you know, what you were just saying about not letting the motivation for you being like trying to be better than the person in the next practice room, but discovering your own, what your own sound is, what your voice is, what you need to learn for your expression of your own internal musical mind to make that, you know, get that out into the world. And I find that the students at Cusstown really do have a, there's a certain maturity about that. They've already gotten to that, or they know it's there and that's what they're pursuing. That's a big deal. What I do, because when I was early on, I mentioned for a second there about I'd kind of messed up my left arm from practicing in all the wrong ways. So I had to learn a different approach, which was much more about something that Kenny Werner, a piano player in his book, Effortless Mastery, and I've known Kenny for 40 some years, and we've talked about this kind of thing forever, but it's about the idea that, you know, having however you can arrive at a kind of a, at the most relaxed and confident place you can be, an attitude of mind and body that you bring to when you practice, when you play with people, if it can be of a certain kind of quality that has to do with that's not about ego and it's not about these other things. I mean, some of the ego thing, which means that gets you to the practice room, maybe just because you want to get better. But the quality of your practice has to be such that you really, you take advantage of that time. You really get a closer relationship with your instrument, so that your technique comes from a place of relaxation and fluidity, and this kind of a certain kind of just like mental, emotional, technical nimbleness and flow. And if you can get to that, however you get to that kind of attitude of mind and body, is what you need to do. For me, I had to learn from Kenny Werner, Keith Jarrett, Schucker, and all these people learned from Madame Shaloff in Boston. She was another great teacher. And her whole thing was, you know, you've got to learn how to just play one note on the piano and have that note emerge from that instrument and fill the room. And Kenny Werner, as great a piano player as he is, he says he spent like 3 months and never got past playing one note with her because he didn't do it right. And yet Kenny went on to write this famous book called Effortless Mastery. And that's like, and that's a, you know, about how do you kind of just become a channel for the music, as opposed to, you know, kind of like, okay, well, I practice this pattern, then I practice this is part of transcription, and this is what this professor said to do here. And, you know, that kind of thing where you have all this kind of, you know, you have to have a certain kind of, history of practicing those kind of things, no question about it, scales and arpeggios and all that stuff. But when it comes to improvising and really kind of discovering who you are on your instrument, you got to figure out what's the best way for you. For me, it was Qigong and learning and talking with Kenny about this kind of like, how do you just play that so that it's just a, you don't really feel it's a tiny little expenditure of energy, just play so that playing the one note has the same sensory implications and feel for playing a flurry of notes. They're both the same. And so Qigong is just like Tai Chi. It's a Chinese series of exercises that focus on meditation and movement at the same time. So it's about breathing. It's about calmness. It's about being still at your instrument. And that comes from, you know, a kind of meditative approach to your practice and a meditative approach to just learning technique, yeah, stuff like that. I also do some more vigorous things, but Tai Chi is the dance-like imitation of hard martial arts, fighting. Okay. Qigong is staying in one place, which is why I've gravitated to that, because you can do it in a practice room. But this idea is that you're doing these slow, meditative, gently stretching movements that allow you to kind of go internal, to think internally about what you're feeling and what, you know, and connecting your breath to what you're doing, so that when you go from there to playing your instrument, you're taking that with you and just applying it to practicing your instrument. And so consequently, when you get into that, then it's like the meditation is not just in the, it's not just when you're meditating. It's not just when you're doing Qigong. It's not when you're doing, everything you do is about that meditation. You carry it through the rest of your day. You carry it into your speech, how you carry yourself, how you walk, you know, what you think about, you know, how you treat people. everything about it, it all becomes the meditation. And that and music is just kind of one of the parts of it. And that, and to me, you'll get better faster, and you discover who you are as a musician. You'll get to that so much quicker every single day if that's kind of where it's coming from, if you kind of employ things like that. So, you know, I'm breathing exercise, stretching, whatever anybody wants to do, yoga, they're all wonderful. Whatever you can do to bring to forget about the distractions of your life, to get to a place where you're physically without, you know, muscle tightness, you're relaxed, and you're really kind of ready to do this activity, that's going to get you there quicker than anything I know of.
Yeah. I wanted to mention, as a saxophonist, there's a book that Dave Liebman, I believe, wrote, and in it he discussed how the saxophone, when you're playing, is an extension of your own human body. Yeah. Would you say that after you started practicing more Qigong, you felt more in tune with you playing the bass and just the bass in general?
I think so. I mean, because it's about the it's about getting to a place of quiet with your instrument, so that the touch and the sound are nourishing. It's like it feels good and it sounds good. The sound nourishes you. That, and that's what he's talking about, the extension of your who you are. So the biggest thing we have to learn is, you know, how do we access all that we've listened to and practiced and studied? How do you get to that so that you start to discover who you are as a musician? You got to discover who you are as a person and as a musician. To me, that's the issue, because, you know, you can make a living just being playing a bunch of different styles on the saxophone. You know, I can sound like Sonny Rollins, or I can sound like Wayne Shorter, I can sound like Trainor, I can sound like, you know, whoever. But what do you, you know, you're never going to sound as good as them. You know what I mean? You'll never sing as good as Sarah Vaughan, because Sarah sang Sarah Vaughan. You know, it's not like, you know, nobody, you know, the people that are trying to imitate Freddie Hubbard or Miles or something like that, you'll never be as good as them. Their responsibility that they took on was to discover their sound and their concept and what they wanted to do. And everyone has that same responsibility. I mean, if you want to be a stylist and just kind of have a derivative kind of like concept, okay, I can sound like this and I can play a little bit like this, that's fine. And you can make a living at that. To me, it's more important to find out what is my contribution? You know, why am I doing this? And I would hope it'd be so that when somebody hears, they say, I know who that is. That's so-and-so. That's because they develop their own sound and their voice. And so that what they play is coming from their emotional history, from their studies, from all of that kind of stuff. If you're not connected with your internal life and soul, whatever you want to call it, if it's not coming from there, then it's coming from a place that's not as deep as it could be. And so to me, our responsibility is to sound like yourself. Find out what that is, because you weren't here to sound like somebody else, because you'll never sound that good. They did it. That's what their responsibility was. So there you go.
Yeah, no, I think that was really well put. I hear from a lot of people these days, sometimes when some students come out of schools, all they hear is just like Charlie Parker or Miles clones, and not enough of individual voices. Now, Scott, we're coming close to kind of the wrap up of this first episode, and I just wanted to ask you a bit of a broad question. So it's a little bit of a thinker, but I wanted to know what the best piece of advice that you've ever been given, or what is the best piece of advice that you could give to anybody out there, not just a musician, anybody.
The first that comes to mind, I'll let that be the determining thing. You're sorrier for the things you don't do than for the things you do. As in, you know, the things that we don't do because we think we can't, we're afraid to, it's inappropriate, or something that not so much inappropriate, but the idea that you would not do something is the hesitancy is the problem, maybe, as opposed to, and this is actually it's a takeoff from something from Mark Twain. That's, but you're sorry for the things you don't do for the things you do. And so, you know, the things you do, yeah, if you do something and it doesn't turn out right, that's being a human. You know, that's what living is. But the fact that you didn't, it's kind of like saying yes to life, as opposed to kind of, well, no, I'm afraid, I don't want to go there. Those kind of impulses keep us from maybe finding out the most important stuff. Mm-hmm. So there you go.
Okay. Yeah. Awesome. I really like that. I really like that message that you just gave, that, you know, you just have to go do it. And if you don't do it and you really wanted to do it, but you don't do it, you're going to regret it. So
it's about why didn't I?
Yeah, why didn't
what
I?
Was I thinking, why didn't I do that?
Yeah,
that'll give you more regret than probably something you did. Maybe you said something that you wish you hadn't, so you apologize. Mm-hmm. You know, what's the big deal?
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah. We just want to thank you for being our first guest on our first podcast.
Yeah, thank you, Scott.
Yeah, we really got a lot out of that. You're a really great storyteller. You're really great at giving advice. So, yeah, we just wanted to ask you one last thing. Where else can we find your discography?
It would be on my website, Scott Lee Music.
Okay, awesome.
So there's some stuff there, but I want to thank both of you. You made it actually very easy, and it was a lot of fun. Thanks so much.
Oh, thank you so much.
All right.
That concludes our last episode. Thank you guys for listening, and you guys have a great day.
Thank you. You too.